Hey everyone, this is Ben Jones with dataliteracy.com. I'm doing a whiteboard series to cover some topics I think are helpful for anyone who works with data on a regular basis. The first one is the four types of data scales. Those four types spell the word noir, N-O-I-R. So we're going to use the example of a bottle of wine to go through each one of them and understand them in more detail. It comes from a 1946 paper by a Harvard psychologist named Stanley Smith Stevens, who was researching how human beings perceive the loudness of sounds. And they needed a common sort of measurement scale to be able to work together with other researchers. The first one is nominal. Nominal data scales are names of things. So think nominal, think names. This could be, you know, the name of the wine maker or the bottler. It could be the type of wine. So let's use that as an example, Pinot Noir or Merlot or Cabernet Sauvignon. So that is the way we classify a type of wine. What's interesting about nominal data scales is there's no notion of greater than or less than. It's just that you can tell if something is the same or not, so equal to or not equal to. But because of that, we can count the number of cases of a certain value and the mode. So the mode is the most numerous one. Let's say we have a crate of 100 bottles of wine. I can count how many of each type of wine are in it, and the one that occurs most frequently would be the mode. But again, there's no notion of greater than or less than, because that comes in the second one with ordinal. Notice with nominal, they're just shapes scattered. There's no real order to them. In ordinal, they are in a certain line and in order. One is greater than or less than. So this could be in wine. Let's say maybe we rate the wine. Maybe I give it a 5-star. Maybe you give it a 4-star. And that would be our way of saying how good we think the wine is. So there's an example of an ordinal data scale. What's interesting about these types of data scales is that there is now a notion of greater than or less than. There's also equal to or not equal to. If I give it a 4, it's not the same as if you give it a 3. Those are different, and we can still count them. But also, there's an order to our scores now, right? So that allows us to do things like medians, the 50th percentile, as well as other percentiles. But what's interesting about ordinal data scale types is that you notice how these symbols are in, they're not quite the same distance apart. Because let's say I give something a 1-star. Now, is that the same improvement if I were to go to a 2-star as if I go from a 4 to a 5-star? Is that the same, like, jump in improvement? Not necessarily, right? So that's why an ordinal data scale type is a little tricky, because there's no notion of, like, the intervals aren't necessarily the same distance apart. So that's what comes with our third data scale type, which is interval. You can see now the symbols are, you know, an equal distance apart. But what's interesting about interval is that there's no absolute zero. This could be like maybe the temperature. Maybe I want to serve up this bottle of wine to a guest of mine at 56 degrees Fahrenheit, because everybody knows that's what you serve Pinot Noir at. But whereas if I were serving them at Merlot, clearly I'd want to serve that at 62 degrees Fahrenheit. And you'd say, oh great, you know, that's a difference or a change of plus 6 degrees Fahrenheit, which is the same change as if you go from a 62 to a 68. So in that sense, the interval or the distance is preserved, which allows us to do addition, subtraction, and compute deltas or changes between successive values of that scale, which also gives us the ability to do the mean or the average, as well as a standard deviation, which is really powerful. Again, we can also do these statistics as well as now some new ones. But because of the fact that the zero point is arbitrary, you know, there's no such thing as like, well, 0 degrees Fahrenheit. There's such thing as it, but it doesn't mean no heat or no temperature. It's kind of an arbitrary zero point. So that's why, even though this is plus 6 degrees Fahrenheit, it isn't plus 10%. If I double the temperature, I don't have like twice as much heat. That's really not how interval data scales work. But that is how ratio data scales work. And you can see for this, I drew them as like larger and smaller circles, because when you get to zero, there's nothing there. And that's true of a ratio data scale type. Like in the example of wine here, maybe I want to take the volume of wine. That's 750 milliliters on the bottle. Well, again, if I had 0 milliliters, right, the circle went all the way down to nothing, there would be no wine. It would be gone. Also, if I have 1,500 milliliters, a larger bottle, that's twice as much wine, or, you know, plus 100%. So now we compute ratios. Now we compute percent changes, and also other more sophisticated statistics like the geometric mean, like the coefficient of variation. All right, so there we go. There's our four data scale types. Really helpful to understand this, also when we're working with data, to know at any given time what a variable or an attribute that we're working with, what data scale type it falls into. But we want to be careful with this scale type. In fact, there was a great paper written back in the 90s by a couple statisticians, Paul Velleman of Cornell and Leland Wilkinson at Northwestern, called Nominal, Ordinal, Interval, and Ratio Typologies Are Misleading. And they just point out that we don't want to be too rigid when we apply this, when we do analysis. We want to have our minds that are open. We also want to be flexible. And sometimes a certain variable might take on different meanings. And to illustrate that, they use a bunch of great examples in this paper, and you'll see the link below. But one example they give would be, let's say we had a soccer team. Okay, here's a little soccer jersey, right? And let's say we handed out jerseys to all the players on the team. So, you know, we just gave the numbers arbitrarily, though. There was no meaning to the numbers in this example. But let's say there were freshmen and sophomores on the team. And let's say the sophomores just happened to notice that their jersey numbers happened to really commonly be greater than, you know, larger numbers, higher numbers than the freshman players' jersey numbers. And let's say they started laughing at them, making fun of them for that. Well, the parents of the freshman players might be justified in going back to the coaches and asking them, you know, is that true? Is there a difference? And, you know, is like the average number less? So we would start to use some of these statistics in what was originally just intended to be a nominal data scale type, right? Differentiating between players on the field actually starts to take on some ordinal or even maybe some ratio type analysis. And so we want to be open-minded and not limit ourselves overly rigidly when we start to understand our data that we're working with, what scale type it is. So there's another couple really kind of, you know, cool examples in this paper I'd encourage you to check out. So again, helpful to understand the scale types and what they are and how to use them. Also helpful to know that it's not a typology or like a framework that we want to be overly rigid with when we use it and apply it. All right, hopefully that was helpful. I enjoyed it. I'm going to be doing a few more. If you liked it, click like, subscribe to the channel. We're going to keep these coming just to keep helping you as you kind of work with data and get better and better at that. All right, thanks very much. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.